few words about what Gyanprabha is, what we do. Very briefly, we've been around for 7 years and we're dedicated to the dissemination of the arts in its widest possible sense. We do it through courses, public lectures, and all kinds of other, performances, all basically to open up the windows of current practice to an audience in Bombay. So furthering our commitment to understanding creativity and the processes involved, we have initiated a series titled Creative Processes, and which comprises lectures and conversations focusing on the backstories of some of the most acclaimed and respected artists of our time and their work. The series looks at an artist's experiments with style, form, and space, not from the perspective of the critic, historian, or curator, but from that of the artist herself or himself. What were the preoccupations that shaped his or her practice? What were the pressing concerns and points of inflection in his or her life, and how did those impact his or her work? For each such session of Creative Processes, we invite an artist to talk about his or her process of working and the choices that are made when confronted with problems to explore the seemingly idiosyncratic ways of expression that enable us to have contrarian views of the world. The inaugural lecture of the series was presented by Atul Dodia, where he spoke of how an image, a narrative, the choice of the medium, and the scale are decided while creating a work of art. He talked about how influences and references mingle and become a cohesive part of the imagery in his paintings. Since then, we've had other artists and authors that have presented their works under this series, and they include Astad Debu, Geef Patel, Nalini Malani, William Kentridge, Malavika Sarukai, Charles Correa, Suada Miri, and Massimo Gonzalez. All these presentations are posted on our YouTube channel, where they can be viewed by any of you should you want to. Dianita is an artist whose medium is photography, and her form often a book of forms inspired by the book. Last year, she had a solo at the Hayward Gallery in London and represented Germany at the Venice Biennale. She has authored 10 books, Zakir Hussein in 1986, Myself, Mona Ahmad in 2001, Privacy 2003, Chairs 2005, Go Away Closer in 2007, Sent a Letter in 2008, Blue Book 2009, Dream Villa 2010, House of Love in 2011, File Room in 2013, and the recent Museum of Chance 2014. I'm quoting Dianita. Starting with Sent a Letter in 2007, I began to explore the idea of the book as an exhibition. This led me in 2013 to the Museum Bhavan. I think I had always known the book was my form. The tactile book that you held in your hands, the Zakir book 1986, had no exhibition, no prints on the wall, but it took me 30 years to find a form that allowed me to free my images from the wall, from the mat and the frame, and making both the display and the sequencing endlessly changing. This came in the form of mobile museums. Perhaps the most crucial process is not the photography, but the editing. I think I work backwards. I collect images over months and years, and then at a certain time, I stop and start to look at the material and weed out till the bare structure remains. Then I find the form. Rather, it finds itself in the editing process, unquote. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dianita, who has flown in from Delhi just to be with us today.
Thank you. I'm very, very nervous today. Nervous because of where I'm sitting. Nervous because of the subject that we're going to speak about, It's really difficult, you know, to try to talk about the creative process. It's like you're asking me to find my gut and put it out there. So it makes me quite vulnerable. And as I started to think about what I would talk about, and, you know, I have lots of slideshows. I've done whatever they are called very often. And I thought, no, I don't even want to show slides. And can I perhaps try and share what goes into the making of my work? So I've carried whatever I could fit into my beautiful bag from my studio to bring you some objects. And just as a hello to an old friend, I thought I would show you a very special object that I made before I even knew that I was going to be making objects. It was my first show in Bombay at Kemold, at the old Kemold, of portraits we had been trying to convince all the Parsis to pay me to do, and we did them anyway. So Gabriella, can you just help me? So this is how I sort of, I think a lot of what I'm trying to say is, was there, I just didn't recognize it as my form. And this is one of the first objects I had made to explain to Shireen how exactly I may have wanted things to be hung. So just these are my medium format contact sheets, which I had cut up and pasted together. In those days, I must have been in a big hurry, so I did it with this magic tape. And then somehow folded it, and I don't know whether I sent it to Shireen or what I did with it, but just as I was leaving the house and looking through my old shelves, drawers, this thing tumbled out. I hadn't seen it all these years, and I thought, gosh, in 2002 or something like three, I knew it, and I didn't know it. I only knew it now when this tumbled out. And it's sort of the same thing with my the Zakir book. You know, I was a student at NID, and photography was just a way to really not be at NID, to be a visiting student and to travel. And I made the book, and I just made the book. There was no question of exhibition. There was no question of prints. It was just a book, because that's what I thought photography was about. And then I was very embarrassed by the book. And it took me 30 years to realize that actually this is the form. This is where I love to see my work, and this is what I've always loved. But I've also loved to see the work on the wall. So can I find a way to move the book to the wall? And so I will sort of slightly go through all of that in whatever way I can. But to start with, I just wanted to say that, not just, I have many things to say, many papers written again and again. The first, I have three chapters. And I love titles. So the first one is A Voice of One's Own. And the second one is By Chance. And the third one is Ongoingness of Work. These are sort of just my clues for how things have moved. And when I thought about what is it about the creative process that I can share, what is my creative process? And I was quite amazed that it comes from very many different places. And the main training, I would say 80% of my process was really taught to me by traveling those six, seven winters with Zakir and all the classical musicians. And so I haven't really had an artistic mentor as an artist or a photographer. I think my mentor has been Zakir. And the kind of rigor that I learned from him, because what Zakir did was, he just completely sort of would wrap me on the knuckles if I tried to sort of deviate. So it was, you've chosen to be a photographer, you want to make a book on me, that's the reason you're traveling, so get on with it and don't ask Hariji if he can teach you the sitar, the flute, and Nishat if he can teach you the sitar. I'm not going to teach you any tabla, you just focus on your photography. But he did it in a very serious and quite a harsh way and would really get annoyed if I wanted to suddenly study calligraphy. And you know, you're 18 and you want to do all kinds of things. But just from watching him and the musicians, but most of all Zakir, of what I understood, what it means to work within a medium, to really master the medium, to perfect the medium, and then to be able to challenge it, and then to be able to push its limits. And that when Zakir went onto stage, it didn't matter how he had got there, what had happened in his house, who had died even. It was him and his tabla and the audience. And he would get into this, that was all that mattered. And perhaps you would call it selfish, or, but that was the center of his life. Everything else came second. And I think that's how Zakir became also a sort of life guru, that if I really wanted to follow this medium, then I had to put everything into it and everything into demolishing it and everything into restructuring it into again demolishing it, that it would never, never stop. And this, I don't know, unless I sort of drop dead. And Zakir was on the jury at the Venice Film Festival in 2011, and I had just had a little file room work as part of the Venice Biennale. But those of you from the art world will understand, it's, you know, it's such a big deal to be part of that Venice Biennale. So Zakir sent me an SMS from there to say, proud of you, good, something. So I couldn't help being cheeky and saying, well, I'm a little star too. And he said, sweetheart, I hope you never become a star. I hope you never start to even think like that, because the day you do is the day it'll be over. And that's what he really taught me, that it's never enough. It doesn't matter what you do. You have to push. You have to do more. There's always more to do. You've never mastered it. There's more to challenge. There's more to break. There's more to demolish. There's more to move forward. And when I wrote the synopsis of what I would talk about, and I called it Building Museum Bhavan, that was about 3 months ago. But, you know, 3 months is a very long time. And now if you go to the Max Müller Bhavan, you will see that Museum Bhavan has also become the past now, and something else has happened. And while that show is going on, I'm planning something else. So I can barely keep up with myself. And if you feel like leaving at some point in my meanderings, I won't take it personally, because I'm having a hard time containing it all myself. I'm also quite overwhelmed to be here and to have found this. I must save it very carefully. You know, this is also analog. Can you imagine if I had done this on some computer? So anyway, won't go there. I'm not going to talk about photography. Photography is just my raw material, so we're not going to talk about that. So I think this voice of one's own is what I would call a course if I had to teach something to do with being an artist. That really, how does one find one's voice and how does one become the author of one's work? And in my training, remember, I'm coming more from the world of music. It's very much to do with the mentor. It's very much to do with the guru. Even though the guru may not be from your medium, but I think it's all the same. So in later years, I've had wonderful writer friends, and they've done the same thing for me. Somehow, I've been incredibly fortunate in the friends that I've had and the conversations I've been able to have, that it's all sort of helped build this sort of almost autistic focus on what I do and pushing the limits of that and going to my writer friends and saying, I want this from you, I want that from you. Going to Vikram Seth and saying, can I cut up your poems and put them into my books? Can I make a poem out of your titles? But also just all the literature that I started to that I was introduced to by another writer friend. So somehow this finding of the voice, I think, is what has taken these 30 years. And when I had the show at the Hayward with the Museum Bhavan, there were two things that I remember saying. The first was that it's as though everything I had done in my life was in preparation for this, that everything so far was just the riyaz, that I was only now having my arangetram. So a bit late at age 53, but that's what it felt like, that everything had trained me for that moment, for that opening. And then at the opening, there was a beautiful sit-down dinner, and, you know, I was suddenly asked to say something. I was told before I wouldn't have to say anything, and I suddenly had to say something. And so it really came from the heart, and I said, I think I can repeat that. I said, I'm really nothing on my own. I am whatever I am because of the conversations that I've had, and the conversations were with many of the people actually sitting in that room, to my right, to my left, to my side. It was incredible. So I'm also incredibly privileged in the conversations that have somehow come to me, that fall into my lap. But this much I will say, that once I get a whiff of that conversation, I also don't let it go. I also will just, you know, I will follow that to Alaska if need be, because I know that that conversation is very important for me. So my voice has come through. I think I've got the beginnings of a voice now, and I think it really has come through Zakir, the writer friends, the books that I've read, the conversations. And then I have to sort of take all of that, because I don't want to be piggybacking on them. I have to take that, bring it to my medium, and then start to create some work. And that's when chance comes in, and that's when intuition comes in. Intuition, that word that academics hate when they try to ask you to articulate what is it that makes a work. And if you dare to say, use the word intuition, and I dare to use the word intuition, I mean a very informed intuition. It's an intuition that comes after years of study, riyaz. You know, riyaz doesn't really have an equivalent in English. It's not practice, it's not rehearsal. So there's chance, there's intuition, there's conversation, which I spoke about. But then perhaps the most important part of my process, without which nothing new happens, is the addressee. And the addressee becomes the person who I will make a work for. And that's how Sent a Letter was made. It's a series of letters, but I have one of them with me, which is, this is what I mean by an addressee. So I go to Calcutta with my publisher, Steidl, and I make, again, little contact prints and put them in a book for him, because I want him to have a letter from that time. It's not that they're all photographs of him, but they're just things we did together, places we went together. Martin's also in the pictures. And I made one copy for him, one copy for myself. The idea being that the friends could travel with this and show it in different places, and I would have my copy in my house, which is called the Kitchen Museum. But this could only happen because he was the addressee. So I have five books that I've made in Calcutta. They are all five different because they are all five different addressees. So for me, the addressee is really the key. And the addressee, if I really think about it, is really my subject matter. So I can go back to the same places in Calcutta, those same libraries, but I photograph it completely differently depending on who the addressee for that work is. So the addressee is either someone who's traveling with me, most often like that. Sent a Letter comprises of a lot of travels I made with a writer friend to Bombay, to Allahabad, to Devi Gad, sometimes with him, sometimes thinking of him, sometimes longing for him, sometimes angry with him, but for him, that it was always an addressee. And the addressee can be, could even be Calvino. So it's not necessarily a living person, because by the time they become the addressee, they're not even that person. It's a third creature gets created between me and that person, between the addressee. So the addressee is very important, and the gift becomes my way of how I find the form. Every time I've had to make a gift for someone, not had to, I wanted to make a gift for someone, something amazing has happened. I don't have it with me because the same hymn won't give it back to me, but I was going for a New Year's celebration and I thought, I'm going to show him, I'm going to take the best champagne that I could get access to. And I took this big champagne bottle and I stuck my file room photographs on all four sides. Do you follow? This box with photos. And I gave it to him and I said, here's my contribution for the new year. And he said, oh, that looks very interesting. I think it would be quite amazing in about this size, Dayanita. And that's when my structure started. This is the same person who comes to my house and looks at a table full of prints that I put out for him that are somehow connected to paper, somehow. Because he's coming after a long time, I want to show him something very special. So I put out all these prints and I think, let him see something that nobody's seen before. And he pulls out from them 24